Good day, everyone. This is the first part of my lecture presentation in FB 102, Practices in Crop Production. So, Unit 1, Land Preparation, Operations, Machinery, and Equipment. So, the general objective of this unit is to impart knowledge and skills required in preparing lands for annual crop production. Specifically, the unit is aimed to discuss land preparation activities, agricultural power for land preparation equipment, and machinery. So first, what is land preparation? It is the process of preparing the soil to provide a favorable soil environment for plant germination and growth. So, tillage. It is a mechanical manipulation of the soil to provide favorable condition for crop production. Soil tillage consists of breaking the compact surface of earth to a certain depth and to loosen the soil mass so as to enable the roots of the crops to penetrate and spread into the soil. So, there are two classifications of tillage, the primary tillage and secondary tillage. What is primary tillage? It constitutes the initial major soil working operation. It is normally designed to reduce soil strength, cover plant materials, and rearrange soil aggregates. The operations performed to open up any cultivable land with a view to prepare a seed bed for growing crops is known as primary tillage. Animal drone implements mostly include indigenous plow and moldboard plow. Tractor drone implements include moldboard plow, disc plow, subsoil plow, chisel plow, and other similar implements. So what is a moldboard plow? It is a plow equipped with a moldboard, especially a general purpose plow having a moldboard of intermediate length and curvature. It is also called as a turn plow. Moldboard plow cuts, inverts, and breaks spiral slices and turn the upper surface under to borrow weeds and crop residues in the process. The crop ranges from 15 to 30 centimeters. These plows usually have three or more individually mounted concave discs that are inclined backward to achieve maximum depth. They are particularly adapted for use in hard, dry soils, shrubby or bushy land, or on a rocky land. These plows cut without inverting the furrow slice, unlike the moldboard plows. The disc rotates, thereby reducing the friction, thus reducing the required draft power. The depth of cut ranges from 15 to 20 centimeters. Next is the rotary cultivator or rotavator. It is a set of cutting knives or tines which are mounted on a horizontal power-driven shaft which rotates at high speed. So, these knives are made of high-quality hardened steel, and it initially cuts the soil and pulverizes it by centrifugal force. So, the rotary cultivator are PTO-driven or power take-off driven. You will understand the PTO at the latter part of my presentation. The depth of cut ranges from 10 to 15 centimeters. Then we have the chisel plow. It is a tractor-mounted farm implement used for deep tillage, loosening and breaking up soil at depths below the levels worked by moldboard plows, disc harrows, or rototillers, but not as deep as that of a subsoiler. So we are not familiar here with this type of implement. This is typical use in the United States of America and in Europe and maybe other Asian countries with a large or wide area or land holdings. The next is a subsoiler or plat lifter. It is a tractor-mounted farm implement used for deep tillage, It is used to loosen up and break up the soils at depths below the levels worked by moldboard plows, these harrows, rototillers, or chisel plows. The subsoiler will improve the growth in all crops where soil compaction is a problem. It is a kind of plow with no moldboard, used to loosen the soil at some depth below the surface without turning it over. So it's just breaking the soil. Secondary tillage. These are tillage operations following primary tillage. Those are performed to create proper soil tilt for seeding and planting. They are called secondary tillage. These are lighter and finer operations performed on the soil after primary tillage operations. Secondary tillage consists of conditioning the soil to meet the different tillage objectives of the farm. The implements include different types of harrow, cultivators, levelers, clod crushers, and the likes. First, we have the spike tooth or the peg tooth harrow. This is the most common. A harrow equipped with a straight teeth on horizontal bars, usually employed to smooth and level plowed soil or set beds for planting or sowing. So here we have the samples of the peg tooth harrow. This one is being, this is Carabao drone. And this one is as an implement in the two-wheel tractor or in the walk-behind tractor. This one is another type of peg-tooth harrow. It's a tractor drone harrow. Then we have this harrow. This harrow is slightly concave disc mounted on a common axle. This is the common axle. The front end of the disc cuts the soil and crop residues, while the trailing edge raises the soil and push it to one side. So the difference between the disc harrow and the disc plow, this is the most significant difference. You can see the figure, this structure. So this is the main difference between the disc plow and disc harrow. So let's proceed to the land preparation operations in rice productions. So there are three systems being utilized. The first one is the wetland tillage. The second one is the dryland tillage. And the drill method or zero tillage. So we have here the wetland tillage. As you can see, as you can observe, the presence of the water. So here another example of a wetland tillage. This is a hydro tiller being utilized in a deep muddy portions of the field are where common tractors or common machines cannot work. So this is in Ugbot. So another type, another example. So this is in Pampanga. Pampanga Agricultural College, now Pampanga State Agricultural University, my alma mater. This is way back in 2001 during my farm entrepreneurship program under Shell Filipina, Filipina Shell Foundation Incorporated as a scholar. So here another example. Another picture. So wetland tillage is not just utilized in the lowlands, it is also utilized in the uplands. For example, in Banawe, and the Banawe rice terraces, they are utilizing the wetland tillage method. So the next is the dryland tillage, as the word implies. This is both for lowland and upland fields where the soil is dry during land preparation. So this is in Cantil, Roas, Oriental Mindoro. So dryland tillage is being practiced, not just practiced in the lowlands, but also in the uplands, in the mountains. As you can see here, those practicing kaingin, the slash and burn method. So they are utilizing the dryland tillage. Then with the drill method or the zero tillage, this is mostly practiced in the uplands. It is utilized in areas where the use of machinery is post danger or not applicable. Those areas that are too steep for the machines to be operated. Only the spot where the seed is to be placed were cultivated. It is a great help in soil conservation. Now let's proceed to the sources of agricultural power for land preparation. A farm power for various agricultural operations can be broadly classified as tractive work, such as land preparation, cultivation, harvesting, transportation, hauling, etc. And stationary work, like threshing, winnowing, lifting of irrigation water, drying, milling, and the likes. So these operations are done by different sources of power. The first one is human power. Human beings are the main source of power for operating small tools and implements. The advantages or the advantage, humans are easily available. Manpower is easily available and used for all types of work. The disadvantage, the costliest power compared to all other forms of other types of power, farm power. So the efficiency is very low. It requires full maintenance when not in use. So they have to eat, they have to drink, and affected by weather condition and seasons. So because man cannot work during bad weathers, during the hottest time of the day, the man can still work. But the speed may vary. No? On an average, a man develops nearly about 0.1 horse power. So the second one is the animal power. So mainly, bullocks and buffaloes are the principal sources of animal power. However, in the other areas, in the other countries, they are utilizing camels, horses, donkeys and elephants, and are also used for perhaps other types of animals. Now, the average force a bullock can exert is nearly 3 to 1/10 of its body weight. The power developed by an average pair of bullocks is about 1 horsepower per usual farm work. The advantages: animals are easily available. It is used for all types of work. Low initial investment. It can supply manure to the field and fuels to farmers. They live on farm produce, so the maintenance is low. Disadvantages: animals are not efficient. Now, seasons and weather affect the efficiency. For example, the carabaos, they cannot work during the hottest time of the day, and it cannot work at a stretch. You have to make them rest. They require full maintenance when there is no farm work. So even there is no farm work for them, you have to feed them, you have to give them the other requirements in order for them to live. It creates unhealthy and dirty atmosphere near the residence. So if you have plenty of animals, the dungs that they are producing in a day, and of course animals are very slow in doing work. So third is the mechanical power. Heat engines are the main source of power for agricultural machinery, especially nowadays that we are on that we are mechanizing the farm operations. So the advantages, the efficiency is high, it is not affected by weather, it can run stress, it requires less space and cheaper form of power. So machine farm machineries can work as long as, for example, you have fuel. The machine can run for continuous hours as long as you are able to maintain the requirements, fuel, water, and the others. The disadvantages, initial capital investment is high. The fuel is costly in repairs and maintenance needs technical knowledge. So today, the price of diesel is around 42, somewhere around that, 42 per liter. So, of course, when it comes to repair, and the price itself of the, for example, a farm tractor, it will cost you around 800 to 1 million and more if you are going to buy a new one. For a smaller and used tractor, maybe around 150,000, 200,000 will do. So mechanical power, a heat engine is a machine which converts heat energy into mechanical energy. The combustion of fuels such as coal, petrol, diesel generates heat. This heat is applied to a working substance at high temperature. By the expansion of this substance in suitable machines, heat energy is converted into useful work. So there are two types of engines, the petrol engine and the diesel engine. The petrol engine, it consists of carburetor, they are carburetor type, spark ignition engine. While the diesel engine are compression ignition engines. Of course, they work using fuels. The petrol engine, it is the engine in which liquid fuel is atomized, vaporized, and mixed with air in correct proportion before entering into the cylinder, engine cylinder during suction stroke. The fuel is ignited in the cylinder by an electric spark. So, diesel engine. In this engine, during suction stroke, only air is entered into the cylinder and compressed. The fuel is injected through fuel injectors and ignited by heat of compression. So there are two types of engine cycles. So engine cycles or internal combustion engines are classified in two types depending on the period required to complete a cycle of operation. When the cycle is completed in two revolutions of the crankshaft, it is called four-stroke cycle engine. When the cycle is completed in one revolution of the crankshaft, it is called two-stroke cycle engine. So this is a four-stroke cycle engine, the gasoline engine. So we have here the four actions: intake, compression, power, and exhaust. So during the intake here, the air and fuel mixtures is drawn in, so being pulled here. It will enter into the intake valve. And then, in the next stroke, in the compression, so the piston will go up, it will compress the air and fuel mixture. So the valves are closed, both the intake valve and the exhaust valve are closed. Then the power, so due to the compression, it will create the explosion of the air and fuel mixture, and then it will force the piston down. So the next action is the exhaust. Because of the explosion, the piston will go down, and then it will go up again, and then the exhaust valve will open and the exhaust gases will come out. So that is, this is the four stroke cycle engine. This is the four stroke cycle engine. The difference is that during the intake, only air is coming in to the compression chamber, to the cylinder. So if you can see here, the air comes in during the intake. During the compression, when the crankshaft rotates, it will compress the air, and then the fuel injector will inject a certain amount of the fuel, then it will explode because of the compression. And in the exhaust action, the exhaust valve will open, and then the burned fuel or the gas, because of that explosion, will come out. And we have here the two-stroke cycle engine. You are quite familiar with this. If you are familiar with the Yamaha and Suzuki, Kawasaki motorcycles, or those engine that are using two-stroke oils. So here, you only have two actions here of the crankshaft, the upstroke and the downstroke. So during the upstroke, the fuel is compressed and ignited. So the passage of the fuel mixture is different if you are going to compare it with the four-stroke engines. So, and then in the downstroke, because of that compression, because of that ignition, it will force down the piston, and then the transfer port is open again. Then the fuel mixture will force into the cylinder. Then the burned fuel will be pushed out by the compressed fuel mixture. So let's proceed to the cooling system of the engines. Now we have the air cooling system, just being cooled. The engine is being cooled by using air. In this type of cooling system, the heat, which is conducted to the outer parts of the engine, is radiated and conducted away by the stream of air, which is obtained from the atmosphere. So in order to have efficient cooling by means of air, providing fins around the cylinder and cylinder head increases the contact area. That's why if you can observe in, if you have motorcycles, and of course, I assume everybody was able to see a motorcycle, able to ride a motorcycle. If you are going to observe the engine, you can see the pins. So it is for the engine to cool down. So the next one is the water cooling system. So the engine is being cooled down by the water being forced into the system. So the water cooling system serves two purposes in the working of an engine. The first one, it takes away the excessive heat generated in the engine and saves it from overheating. It keeps the engine at working temperature for efficient and economical working. So this will end the first part of my lecture presentation in land preparation.